We are so thrilled to have you all here. Thank you for supporting this free community program here at the Whaling Museum. We are thrilled to welcome Sarah Oktay, the director of the UMass Boston Nantucket Field Station. Sarah has been on Nantucket for 10 years and originally hails from the state of Oklahoma. She is here to give us an update on the amazing work that her organization has been doing on the island as of recently. So please join me in welcoming Sarah Oktay.
Thank you, Lindsay. Can everyone hear me all right? Yay, good. Good mic work. Thank you very much for to the Nantucket Historical Association for inviting me. The NHA is one of the primary partners for the UMass Boston Nantucket Field Station, and all of our programs and things that we do, we try to do in collaboration with the Athenaeum, with the NHA, and with many of our great partners here on island. And I'm going to go through probably, 10 more slides than you want to see, but I'm going to go through a series of slides talking about our research, education, and outreach opportunities and programs that we're running at the field station. And I'm pretty flexible. If you have questions as we're going along, you can feel free to raise your hand or jump in. I'll try to go fast enough where we'll have some time at the end for questions. And I won't be covering everything I do, so if there's specific things that you want to know about, please let me know. And I have, our field station is open 7 days a week, 365 days out of the year, thanks to the largesse of the Nantucket Conservation Foundation. We're open to the public. All of our paths are mowed. You can come walk them. We've got a nature trail. I'm usually in the lab. And we've got flyers that, of course, I forgot to bring, that tell you all about our program. So if you're there, always poke your head into the lab and look for a flyer and say hi to me. So I'm sure I can see that at least three quarters of the audience is familiar with the field station. There'll be a couple of slides that might be repetitive or something you already know, but this is a great aerial image showing the field station itself. 107 acres sitting right here on Pulpus Harbor with the 17-acre Folgers Marsh. And the field station itself, we've got a series of buildings right here, and you get to us at 180 Pulpus Road. Now, one of the reasons why it's so important to have a field station on Nantucket, and you guys might not even know what a field station is. I'm a member of the Organization of Biological Field Stations. There's 240 of us around the world, located in remote locations, in urban areas, in plains, and in grasslands, and in caves, and in all kinds of cool areas around the country. And we act as remote satellite outposts for scientists, educators, and the public to be able to interact with nature and do research and science. So our field station on Nantucket is important because we're located here on an island, 26 miles from the mainland. We actually act as our own laboratory. We have a series of different habitats that are all localized here on our 50 square miles worth of land. We can control our own pollution. We don't have to worry about anything except some atmospheric pollution overall. From the mainland, we get a little bit of currents and a little bit of ocean pollution, but not too much. So we can control our own destiny. We actually can watch evolution occurring. We're seeing changes in morphology with some of our plants and animals just in the short amount of time that we've been separated from the mainland. And you guys all know, of course, we were formed by a glacier, a whole nother talk about our natural history, but we were formed by a glacier 13 to 14,000 years ago. As that glacier retreated and the water rose, we became an island. And our island has lots of terrestrial and marine habitats, so the field station takes advantage of both of those. Here are some of the different habitats that we have on island. We also form the southern boundary for a lot of northerly creatures, both plants and animals and birds. So a lot of Arctic-type creatures make it as far south as Nantucket, and some southerly creatures were the northernmost extent. So we act as what's called a floretic divide. And why that's important is Nantucket itself is a bellwether type organism or location for climate change research. So as we see different types of animals and plants either moving further south or further north, some place like Nantucket is a perfect location to record these changes. We also have a very unique situation in that we're missing most of our middle mammals. So we only have a few mammals here and not very many predators. So a lot of our nesting shorebirds have a fighting chance because they don't have to worry about coyotes or raccoons or wolves eating their eggs. And so we have a really great habitat for shorebirds, for nesting, for lease terns, for piping plovers. And because of this kind of unusual habitat, where we're missing a lot of the middle mammals, which would include raccoons, porcupines, skunks, things like that, we've kind of skewed towards some interesting creatures that normally would not have as good a chance of surviving on the mainland. And one of the things that I do, and for people who don't know, I'm not a marine biologist, I'm a chemical oceanographer. So I typically study water quality, and I have for years. I work with radionuclides, trace metals, and here on Nantucket with overall water quality, typically with nutrients. So Nantucket is a great research laboratory for that. We're sitting out in the middle of the ocean. I can record what's coming up off of the Gulf Stream and from the southern United States, and then what's happening over in the Sound. And so all of our water is going to come down from the sky through precipitation, and that is going to recharge our groundwater. We have a great groundwater system, a big aquifer underneath us that's not connected to anyone else. So this is probably the best place I've ever worked to be able to look at pollution sources and put monitoring equipment, wells, and our brains in between where pollution's coming from and what we're drinking and what our ecology and water resources are like. So it's a really excellent test tube type environment for someone like myself that's a water quality scientist. I'm sorry, I know I speak very quickly. I'm trying to slow down, but if I get way too fast, just, you know, do that or something like that. Here's an aerial picture of the Nantucket Field Station. This was donated back in 1963 by the Peabody family through the Nina Haven Foundation. We're actually starting up a new collaboration with the Nina Haven Foundation, which is based down in Florida. The Folgers Marsh here was given by the Folgers family, and it's a gift of 17 acres of this marsh. And then the Conservation Foundation bought this entire property from the UMass system back in 2004, and are graciously allow us to use this upper portion for science research and education. So the land is owned and taken care of by the Conservation Foundation and UMass Boston. And Lenny and I are, my husband's back here, he's our education coordinator and our groundskeeper and master of all trades there at the field station. So when you're running around the field station, if you don't see me, you're gonna see Lenny. And he knows as much, if not more than I do, about the field station. Here is a great overview of this that shows the water resources, our freshwater pond, our office, the dormitory, our residence, and our lab. And all of this is open. And there's no hunting allowed in the off season, so it's a great safe place to come walk your dog. Dogs are allowed on a leash with a doggy baggie with you. Okay, so I do a ton of different research projects. I actually use a huge team of intelligent people, which are known as Nantucketers. I have tons of kids and adults and people of all ages that help me do a lot of science. The one disadvantage I have living here on Nantucket is that we just have a small cadre of professional scientists to get paid to actually help do science. So citizen science is a big part of our programs, and because there's so many fantastic people here on the island that are willing to help us, whether they're 10 or 100, we get a lot of work done. And honestly, the equivalent of facilities that are up on the mainland. So a lot of my research is citizen science, and I've actually coined a term calling it guerrilla science, because we can go out and react to stuff very quickly because I've got half this room that I can call to jump over to the field station and go look at something, whether it's bees or a harmful algal bloom. A lot of the research I do looks at different types of water, and we have two different terms for water that I'm going to use today. Surface water, which is the water you can see on the surface, and that would be a pond, the harbor, the ocean, or a spring that's burbling out of a cliff. We've got three different types of surface water, fresh water. We've got a huge adopt-a-pond program where we go and look at ponds like Sacagawea Pond, Washington Pond, Pest House Pond. We've got salt water, Nantucket Harbor, and then we've got brackish water, which would include Hummock Pond, Sacagawea, and all the salt marshes. So I have water quality research projects going on pretty much almost year-round in all of these different types of water bodies. Also, what we do on island, and I think this is probably one of the more powerful tools we have, is looking at groundwater. So because Nantucket has such shallow groundwater, only about 6 feet, if you start digging, you're gonna hit groundwater. Oh, honey, there's some minus husband points there. You're gonna hit 6 feet. If you dig really quickly, you're going to hit groundwater within about 6 feet on average on the island. Some areas of the island, it's as shallow as 18 inches, and some parts of the island is down to 30 or 40 feet. So what I do is I install wells around the island, and I put these wells between a pollution source, or between something that I want to monitor, and a surface water body like a pond or the harbor. So you can have a house with a septic system and maybe fertilizing, put a couple of wells between that house and the downslope surface water, and see what that house or what that system is contributing. And that's unusual. Usually when you do water quality measurements around the world, and I've done this, you take a snapshot. You run out there and you grab a bucket of water and you come up back and you test it for all kinds of different things, and it tells you what was in the water at that day. What's cool about Nantucket is I can actually get an idea of the sources of the pollution, the vector directions, and what the contribution loads are. And that helps us actually police ourselves much more effectively than on the mainland. Does that make sense to everybody? Okay, great. So this is a bunch of us in the lab getting ready to use all this different equipment. This is students from our Nantucket semester program, which I'll talk about quite a bit. So we've done about 1,000 of these measurements this year. What I do is I run out with my students and we collect water from either a kayak or from a well or from a bigger boat, and we look at a series of things, basic chemical parameters like the temperature, the pH, the amount of dissolved oxygen in the water. All of this tells us a little bit about the health of the water. We also look at nitrate and phosphate, which are the two primary things of concern on island, and that can come from septic systems and from fertilizers, and also from pesticides and a variety of things, road runoff, dog poop, all those kind of things contribute nitrogen and phosphate to our water systems. In a freshwater system, if you get a lot of phosphate, you're going to get an algae bloom, and I'll show you a couple pictures of that. In a saltwater system, if you get too much nitrogen, you get an algae bloom, and you start having problems in your harbor. You end up having phytoplankton blooms that shade out the eelgrass. So both of these two chemicals are our biggest concern on island. We don't have to worry about tanning plants or huge pesticide farms or things that they really have to worry about on the mainland. We don't have as much gasoline pollution or pollution from large factories, but we do have very quick moving groundwater. We have a lot of sand, so if I took, and this would be a great experiment, if I poured out a thing of dye right here, we can actually count how quickly that's going to get into the groundwater. That's going to get in the groundwater in less than a day. We have the fastest recharge rate in the United States because there's so much sand. There's not a lot of soil underground to grab those particles, whether it's a dye or phosphate or nitrate. In America, there's a lot of soil that's actually part of the land. Because we're a sand body, really a sand castle out at sea, we don't have all that soil to grab these particles. So it behooves us to use less of everything because it can get into our groundwater. If I can measure nitrate or phosphate in the groundwater or in a pond, it escaped from somewhere. It wasn't recycled or it wasn't kept on either in your septic system or in your fertilizer. I use a variety of different systems that are all EPA equivalents. Sometimes we'll send stuff off to the mainland to look at nitrogen using a state lab. And all of this here we can do within an hour of collecting the sample. So what's really nice is my students and I can run out, collect a sample, and if we see a problem, we could go right back out again and say, was that something we did? Is there really a problem? Is there a major source of pollution that we need to alert the town about? We also do a lot of coliform testing, and that's a big word for bacteria testing. We would look for both fecal coliforms and total coliforms. A lot of this stuff is naturally in our soil and in our waters, so it's nothing to freak out about. But if we see fecal coliform in some areas, we probably shouldn't. And we actually look in different ponds and areas where there are birds, dogs, and people, and seals. And I have to say, between those four groups, people are the worst as far as contributing fecal coliforms to our ponds and harbor. So here is a typical pond. Pest House Pond, this is over in the Shimo Monomoy area. We've been looking at this pond now for about 9 years, and we've got groundwater wells all around this pond. I'm happy to say that this algae is not existing in near this type of concentration anymore. Back then, this was a 3-foot pond with about 2 feet of algae, so if you ran really fast, you could almost cross the pond. And you couldn't row the pond. If you were rowing, it was that much algae. You could not kayak or row the pond. But what we did is we went, here are different possible sources, and we put groundwater wells between possible sources in the pond, and we were able to pin down which direction and which sources were contributing, and we shared this information with all the neighbors so that they were able to actually take the power and the control and have the scientific evidence. I mean, it's one thing for me to tell someone something, but if I show them these measurements and show them exactly where the well is and how deep it is, then you can figure out, is it me or is it my next door neighbor? Doing this, the same kind of groundwater work in areas where we're sewering new parts of the island like Monomoy, so we can look at improvements over time. And I'm doing the same thing at the fuel station after putting in about a $300,000 septic system. I've got groundwater wells installed between my septic system and the marsh, so I can see if my money was well spent and if I'm actually reducing my own impact. Does that all make sense? So I'll show you a couple of different slides. Here's some of my students out at the pipe that connects from Pest House Pond into the harbor. And this is the end of the dock here, and this is all of our equipment. And they can get out there quickly and back quickly and get some results that are comparable year to year. Here's some students that are out at Tom Nevers. We've been doing Tom Nevers Pond for a long time. Tom Nevers sadly has a lot of phosphate in it, not too much nitrate. And we think that that phosphate actually comes from a ways away. Here's what a typical chart looks like, and you're not going to have to be tested on this, but this shows how these numbers change over time, and typically as the season goes on from June to October, all of these things will start ramping up. So one of the questions we have, and you'll see that in a couple of slides, is how much of this is attributable to people? And one of the key indicators is how much all of this goes up in June and July. And in fact, we'll see big peaks around July 4th and around August 13th. In almost all our data. So we can see how all of this has increased because there's more people on the island. Even in our homes, there might be 20 people using our bathroom instead of two, right? So those 20 people are putting more stress on that septic system, where in January you're not going to see that input. And we can also see if there are areas, this is in five or six different backyards, and there's some people that are not doing having any problem at all. This number right here, 0.5 milligrams per liter, that is the safe number for nitrogen in the water. That's a number you want to see. So all of these above that line are too high. Now fortunately, in the pond pipe and the harbor pipe and the harbor itself, and then this well right here, they're not too bad. We could do a whole talk on the total maximum daily loads, but these numbers are a little bit higher than you'd want to see. They're a tad bit higher than the total maximum daily loads. Here is a quick chart that shows total coliforms, and once again we see those rising up right around September and October. These have a lag time as they finally die off in the water column, and fortunately they all drop down. Some of that's because it's warmer temperature too. There's bacteria in the water, and then that water warms up, and so the bacteria grows faster. This though is not necessarily a good thing. Here's where we're seeing in the harbor these big jumps in coliforms, and these don't tend to be linked to anything like seals or dogs or birds. They truly are linked to human occupation. Not that you're going to want to let your dogs or your birds or your seals all poop right by the water, but it's mainly our fault. Here's some more nitrate levels. Once again, for these different ones, everything above this line is considered eutrophic or hypereutrophic, which means we're feeding these ponds and the groundwater too much. And that's the analogy I use the most. Almost all of this is related to food that we're putting in the groundwater for our lawns or food we're putting in our bodies. When we see these high numbers in our ponds and our harbor, it's basically like fat. This is food that wasn't utilized and wasn't recycled. You can do liposuction, you can suck all of this fat out of there, but if you don't stop the eating, you're going to end up in that same situation. So a lot of people just approach it from a let's remove that material, but you've got to stop the inputs. This next thing is some research we've been doing in Hummock Pond for about 7 or 8 years, and we've got a series of sites along Hummock Pond that we take water quality samples from, and several different wells, too, that are alongside either side of Clark's Cove. This picture shows we did a kayak transect to measure how much Phragmites was growing along Hummock Pond. Phragmites australis is a type of invasive plant that unfortunately we're seeing all over the island. That's the stuff that looks like giant waves of wheat. It's very pretty, but it's very invasive. And so the Conservation Foundation and us and many other groups on island like the Land Bank are working to reduce Phragmites. But in order to see if what you're doing works, you've got to measure what you have out here. This is actually a very pleasant day for a student. You're kayaking along and you've got your GPS and you're like, on, off, So my students have a pretty good life when it comes to being outside. Here's a bunch of other geographic information system and GPS type projects. And in a nutshell, this is just using ways of mapping and how to apply that to science or to history or to education. So my students might map a neighborhood and then track the changes in home values over time, and that would be a socioeconomic study. They might map a conservation area, look and see how often it's been burned, how the plants are changing over time, and that'd be our natural history survey. So it's using tools like maps and applying it to geographic information that we can then use to tell what kind of science is occurring. We've been a key leader in tick-borne disease research for about 40 years. Both Tufts, Harvard, and Yale come to the field station and gather our bunnies and put out and our ticks. They don't take them all away, I wish they did, but they come and sweep net for ticks, and they do blood testing on the ticks, and they do bunny testing to look and see what types of diseases are being held within these different types of animals. So, of course, bunnies have tularemia. The deer are the final vectors in the winter time for ticks before they drop off and have babies. And they'll look at all of these different reservoirs of blood and look for the bacteria that gives us Lyme disease and some of these other diseases. And most of the diseases have actually been discovered through work done at the field station. And they still do that. We've been doing seal research for about 40 years. Here's a picture of some gray seals on Muskeget back in 2005. And we've had population experts at the field station doing seal counts since about the mid-70s. So we've watched the increase in seals, and you guys might have seen some of the forms that we've done on seal research. And we're continuing the seal research, looking to see about the exchange rate between Nova Scotia and our island, because a lot of the seals are going back and forth. We're tagging the seals and looking how far they have to go ashore in order to feed. And some of these seals go 100 miles, 200 miles offshore to Georgia's Bank in order to eat. So we're finding that they go much further than we thought. I have a new collaboration with the Whale and Dolphin Conservation Society, Shearwater Excursions, and the Nantucket Marine Mammal Conservation Program. And this is something where we share an intern. So an intern comes here and lives on the island. I provide housing. They do water quality research for me. They do science research for the Nantucket Marine Mammal Conservation Program, and they serve on the Shearwater as an interpreter. So this one student gets three different opportunities to have these different internships, and they provide, in a manner, free help for us, and someone that's out on the boats that's actually able to talk to people about what's occurring. What's really special about this program is before this program, we didn't have any information on right whales or humpback whales south of Cape Cod. There was no whale boats that had scientists on board in the summer south of Cape Cod. So now we're getting all this information on right whales and humpbacks and minke whales and pilot whales that they never had. And all of this information goes to the state. And we're a popular area. We had about 30 different humpbacks. They had one for most of the summer off of Cape Cod. So all the whale boats were going to look at this one poor humpback named Nile, where all the other humpbacks are like down here on our boats. So scientifically, we would have said, oh my God, there's a huge plummet in the humpback whale population. We don't know where they're going. But by having this one intern, such a simple thing, such a simple, inexpensive program, we were able to document exactly what was happening with the humpbacks. And all of that's linked to where food is moving, how temperature is changing the ocean, where our bait fish are going. All of this is all linked. So it's not, none of this is independent in and of itself. We've been doing a lot of research on horseshoe crabs. We do this in collaboration with Mariah Mitchell Association and with the Nantucket Conservation Foundation. All three of us have three different horseshoe crab groups. And so in May and June, if you guys are bored, you can come out at 3 a.m. and help Victoria and I count. The horseshoe crabs is actually really beautiful and really fun. Once you get on the waders and you're awake, then it's all easy from there. But we go out and we count the horseshoe crabs at night and in daytime, and we've been documenting the horseshoe crabs population because it's plummeted. So our horseshoe crab population from north of, from Maine all the way down to Florida has dropped anywhere between 75 and 80%. We have really, really decimated horseshoe crab population from a combination of overfishing, overused for medical purposes and plain not caring about them. We didn't have any regulations, so I could take my truck and go grab a bunch of horseshoe crabs and, I don't know, make a pyramid out of them. There was no regulations out of them. So now we've got regulations and all these states are working together. These guys provide a primary food source for red knots, for a very popular bird, shorebird, and so the birders are the first people to really notify us when these poor guys were really dropping down. And now we're putting little tags. You can see this tag right here. And so there's a series of different scientists that are tagging them so we can see where they go. They go way offshore in deep water in the winter, and then they come ashore in May and June during the high tides to lay their eggs. And it's really quite beautiful, though we're kind of bleary-eyed doing that. I've been doing mosquito research for the town, kind of haphazardly, but I've been doing testing for the town, and now the Vector Disease Control Institute, Vector Disease Control Organization has been hired from the town, and I provide lab space. So a lot of people don't know, but I provide lab space to state agencies, to Fish and Wildlife, Mass Natural Heritage, the NCF, Mari Mitchell, Land Council, Linda Loring, all of these different groups. So we act as a lab center on the island that anyone can use. And that, I think, is an important part of what a state organization should do. So for quite some time, we've been testing the mosquitoes for EEE, Eastern Equine Encephalitis, and for Western Nile. And those two things are the two primary diseases we're concerned about. And we're very fortunate on Nantucket that we do not have to worry about these. But we've been staying on top of them as far as vector analysis and testing. And now that the town is actually putting real money into the program, Emily Hibbert has been here all summer working in my lab and has collected thousands of mosquitoes and done testing for these diseases. This is probably one of our more gee whiz, oh my God type projects. This is the Geobacter project run out of UMass Amherst. And this is a bacteria that does two cool things. It generates its own electricity and it scavenges uranium and other heavy metals. So you can make I can take a bucket of mud, take it out into a Superfund site, pour it on the ground, and it will start scavenging heavy metals and uranium. I can take the same bucket of mud and take it out to Darfur and use it as a battery. So it generates, it makes its own self-generating electricity. This lab alone is a $30 million lab funded by the Department of Defense. Our mud on Nantucket at the fuel station is their favorite mud in the entire world. They spend $500 to $1,000 each trip just to come over on the ferry with a special bucket to grab our mud and then go home. And then they take the mud. They do. It's really amazing. They have 30 grad students. This is a highfalutin, when they show up, I just get out of the way. I'm like, all right, you go. It's a really cool lab. This is amazing science. It was featured in Time magazine. It's some of the most important science and research done in the United States now. And what they do is they take this bacteria, bring it back home to their lab, and then they keep cloning it and growing it. So our mud forms the base organism for their bioarrays. And they've now, I think, got 75 patents and about 200 papers. I mean, they're just nuts. They're very hardworking. We do a lot of scallop research, and we try to help the town with some of their research on the scallops. We act in a support position because the town does such a great job, and there's folks at Mariah Mitchell that do a great job. This is what has been happening with our scallop population over the years. I've helped with the harbor plan and with the scallop management plan on trying to figure out what's occurring here. And basically, from a high of 120,000 bushels back in 1979, we've gone down to what we were hoping was a sustainable amount of about 15,000 bushels, and then this only goes to 2005 and 2006, but we've had a couple of really lean years that are a combination of harmful algal blooms, lack of recruitment, changes in current, not as good a water quality as we need, problems with eelgrass. We do a lot of eelgrass surveys, and we help the state do their eelgrass surveys. So we do transects. This is another popular job. If you're a 12-year-old, and you want to snorkel, this is the job for you. We put a big, long transect in the water, and then the kids snorkel with a big, giant transect, and they actually count the eelgrass in each section, and they measure it from distance from the shoreline, so we can see how the eelgrass is moving around. We can see how much of the eelgrass was lost from some of the storms we had this spring, for instance. We do a lot of underwater photography and analysis of lingbia, which is this slimy witch's hair that grows on the eelgrass, Fortunately, this year we're not seeing that much lingbia, but that's an indicator of too much food in the harbor. I'm not going to read the whole thing to you, but I will click to the next thing. This is using trace metals as environmental tags. And in a nutshell, we can, even though we don't have a lot of factories or stuff here on island, there is enough difference in the metal content in the harbor that I can take a core sample at Pocomo and a couple of scallops from Pocomo, and I can take them and measure them on this laser ablation X-ray diffraction machine, and I can distinguish scallops that are growing at Pocomo from some that are growing at Third Bend, Children's Beach, Brant Point, or the head of the harbor. There's enough of a difference that you can actually pinpoint the location. Where this is important is in recruitment. Where should we put all of our spat? Where are they gonna grow to be, you know, active, healthy adults? So we look at the little tiny spat. In fact, we're collecting just this week, and we're using this scanning electron type imaging to distinguish the trace metals on them. That's kind of highfalutin, but does that make sense? This is all of our different locations that we've been looking at. So we're basically getting a chemical fingerprint. I use the same thing at the World Trade Center and in the Gulf of Mexico. There's millions of ways and locations where you look for things that are tracers. So basically you look for specifics. And here's how we were able to predict what zones would be best for recruitment or for putting new spat. And that's a whole, we can do a whole talk on that. But the point is that we need to know where our scallops are going, what parts of the harbor are best habitat, and where recruitment or the ability for babies to actually become adults does the best. The field station, I think, also really excels in policy. And you guys probably know I do a lot of work with fisheries management. I was helped write the harbor plan and implemented it. Of the harbor plan, which had 122 action items, we implemented 76% of those action items. There's not a management plan in the United States that I know of that had a higher implementation rate. So not only did we spend 2 or 3 years sitting down, writing it together with all these awesome volunteers, but we put that plan into action. And a lot of towns just write the big plan and stick it on the shelf and they never see it again. Right now we're in the middle of the coastal management plan. Next meeting's October 28th. There's a pond water quality plan that the town is writing. And I provide the town scientific resources and information on groundwater and on surface water, especially things like Hummock Pond. Whenever we have those blue-green cyanobacteria alerts, usually that's coming from my lab. We've got something exciting coming up, and this is one of the things I didn't want to forget to tell you. We've got our Biodiversity Initiative conference coming up. The Biodiversity Initiative, I think, is one of the greatest things about Nantucket. So it's the head of Murray Mitchell, Linda Loring, Land Council, Mass Audubon, all of, you know, Ernie, Emily, Cormac, all these people that you know, we all work together to bring scientists to the island for very little money every summer to do research. We offer small grants, and we do a biodiversity week 1 year, and the next year we do a conference. So November 1st, 2nd, and 3rd, all of these scientists are gonna come and present both at the Nantucket Athenaeum and at the Nantucket Hotel. And you're going to get to learn about snakes, spiders, ants, bees. It's going to be awesome, and it's free. So very few places in the United States do all these organizations work together for the greater good of science, and that's what this is all about. So I provide a bunch of housing, research space for these guys. Here is the, it'll be in the paper, but I wanted everyone to know, Friday, November 1st, we've got this ant expert that's very well known, and then all day Saturday from 8:30 to 6 on November 2nd, we're gonna have lunch. It's gonna be awesome. And the talks only go 15 minutes. So if you're like, I do not like snakes, then you know, 10 minutes later, it's spiders. And then if you don't like spiders or snakes, and you're not a songwriter, then you can go on to ants or to other things you might like turtles. Who doesn't like turtles? So there'll be all kinds of different talks, and it's really great. It's great for all ages. We're gonna have posters and stuff up, and all of these scientists are giving a talk. Hopefully, like I hope I'm giving mine, where it makes some sense to the public. So we're trying to make this very accessible. The Nantucket Science, Nantucket Field Station, which is me, we give this kind of in-kind support. So we basically help provide housing for all these different researchers, from burying beetle research to oyster catchers, ants, whales, dolphins. Now we're doing bee collections and moth collections for the Smithsonian. And we provided housing for Brian, who was doing the American Oyster Catcher Survey using the telemetry. We also house Mass Fish and Wildlife and Mass Audubon. Without my 40 beds at the field station, these scientists would not be able to work on island. They just wouldn't be able to afford to do it. So we provide housing for the Conservation Foundation and for other groups. You may occasionally see my harbor buoys out there. These are out there streaming up to the web, and these are collecting data. This is us putting them out there. And we're collecting sea surface data and temperature data, and it's streaming online. So as an oceanographer, I'm all about trying to put expensive equipment in harm's way out in the harbor so that my butt doesn't have to be out there when it's 40 degrees like it was last week, collecting water. So I'm actually moving into more of this remote sensing, and this is smart science, where you have to put stuff out in the field, and you get that science up on the web where everyone can use it, and that's a big part of being a field station. We do a lot of harmful algal bloom works, both in freshwater, looking at these different cyanobacteria that produce neurotoxins, and so the signs that you see at Hummock Pond are out of some of our research. We've had a couple of different scientists working at the field station identifying these, and then we do a lot of saltwater research, mainly IDing the Cochlidinium polycrates, the rust tide that we have to worry about. The problem with the rust tide is the scallops like to eat any kind of phytoplankton. They're not very good about not retraining. They just tend to eat this, and it reduces their meat size. They're wasting their time on these Twinkies of the sea that are not very nutritious. And so they're filtering it through. They do have the ability to actually offshoot some toxic algae, which I think is amazing. This year we had Sandra Shumway come down and work with the Marine Department, and she is the a journal editor for the Journal for Shellfish Research and a big-time researcher. But the boat base in Antara and David and a lot of people that are here do a great job on the scallops. Here's some of this harmful algal blooms. This is the rust tide, which is this Polycrates cochlidinium. This is the a combination of blue-green cyanobacteria blooms. It looks like people have poured paint into the water. This is really dangerous. This can really hurt your dog, and it in some parts of the country, it's even been linked to Lou Gehrig's disease. So. And this is only caused by our ding-dongness, I have to say. If we see either of this, we've screwed up. It's not going to happen unless we're putting too much food in either the harbor or in the pond. They don't occur unless it's in an impacted waterway. We're better than the mainland. The mainland has thousands of ponds like this, and the ponds are like this all year round. Ours are only like this when the temperature gets high enough. This is a picture from Hummock Pond from about 2 weeks ago. So this is so toxic that the person taking the picture had to leave after 10 minutes. Eyes burning, coughing, respiratory problems. It's no joke. It's definitely, you don't ever want to see that color in water. There's algae and then there's algae, and that's not good. But we're working on it. We're working on changing the watershed initiatives for Hummock Pond. We're cleaning up all the septic systems. We've got new fertilizer regulations in place. The reason for all these new regulations are to prevent these things. So when you see these best management practices or wonder why everyone's got to get upgraded around these different watersheds, this is why. We're all living on a sandy little island, and stuff gets into our ponds, and we don't want it in our ponds. We're also looking at restoration practices, something like putting a big oyster, floating oyster reef in our harbor could help take up some of this pollution. And there's things you can do in ponds, too. Do a lot of surveying in both the boat basin down here in the harbor and then up at the top of the harbor, and we sample, some years we'll sample on every tide on key times during the summer. Sometimes we'll do every 2 weeks, and I've got two or three scientists or students that are doing this. Here's all of our head of the harbor testing, and we're looking at changes in nitrate, phosphate, and in temperature in these areas. And I'll just show you a couple of quick. So this is showing high tide and low tide, the changes in nitrate and the changes in phosphate, and this is how you can start identifying sources and sinks. Here's the creeks. We could do a whole talk on this, but this just shows you, when you see me out there, I'm not just playing. And it's actually not me, it's usually my students. But this is all based on some student research, and you can see from June how these things start coming up and then really peaking in August. Children's Beach. This is sadly fecal coliform, and you can see that anything above 10 is not a good number, so these numbers are not too good. That's there at the mooring field. Some of these numbers come from boats. This isn't all from on land thing. That's one of the things tidally, we can see that some of these are from people that are being overzealous in cleaning their boats or not being good about pumping out their boats. So if you're on someone's boat and you go, wow, what a nice boat, how often did you get it pumped out? That should be your first question. It's free. Let's call the pump, you know, the headhunter and have it come pump out our boat. I do tons of beach monitoring and beach profiling. Here I am doing it with a group of students there at Codfish Park. We do this with a ton of different volunteers here on island. Here are some measurements from Codfish Park back in 06, and you can see the difference between the long beach in the summertime and a short, steeper beach in the winter. And we were able to see what happened in this last winter. Here's what the profile was. All of the sand got smushed up, and we have a huge dune now at Codfish Park that's about 4 to 5 feet tall that we've been able to monitor. I'm going to jump through those. Here's our electronic field guides. We have a couple of different field guides where we take pictures of moss and we actually upload it so you can discover what you're looking at. We've got some, this is basically a video system that uses solar panels, and we can get cameras out there that can record movement of fiddler crabs or birds. We've got an invert study. I'm probably going to skip over that because time is going quick. So this is just all the cool stuff that's growing underneath our docks. We record these invertebrates because it also tells us a lot about water quality. So there's a lot of invertebrates that do better if the water quality is bad, like sea lettuce. Sea lettuce is a great example. If you see a lot of sea lettuce, it absorbs nitrogen really quickly, so it grows faster than other things if there's too much nitrogen. We do, I've already mentioned that we do a whole bunch of state agency and public policy work. I still have five more slides, sorry. Bunch of other cool stuff from archaeology to webcams, toxicology. We do a lot of hydrologic mapping, so we help the town do mapping of the groundwater, and they spent quite a bit of money, and they've really got a great groundwater map. I've been helping out on Tuckernuck. We've done some of the first sampling for bees, some beach profiling, and mosquito testing on Tuckernuck. The coolest thing, this was just in the paper a couple of weeks, this is, we're doing some seafloor mapping at the harbor and the east shore, and we're partnering with the Provincetown Center for Coastal Studies, so I helped buy this acoustic equipment, and we've been putting that up and down the harbor and mapping the harbor, and they're actually going to put that all together and come present it. And we're also working with Provincetown Center for Coastal Studies to do pharmaceutical sampling. So you'll see me at the end of the jetties taking water samples, and we're looking for the pharmaceutical footprint of the island. So I think we're going to be a low number footprint, but it's not going to be zero because we all take various things. And so what we're doing is measuring on the ebb tide what's coming out of our harbor and comparing that to what's happening in the sound. So we've got scientists over at Falmouth, Woods Hole, McCoit Bay, and Hyannis measuring different levels of pharmaceuticals to see how these different pharmaceuticals are moving in our water. And these pharmaceuticals get concentrated into fish. So if you eat, and it's, you know, it's a huge issue all over the United States, but there are places in the United States where there's so much testosterone in the water or so much estrogen from things like birth control pills or from Rogaine that it actually changes the sex of the fish and the frogs that live in these waters. So this sounds kind of crazy, but ironically, you can measure caffeine in almost every harbor. So the, you know, the whole Boston Tea Party thing, we drink so much tea and coffee, we can measure it in almost every water body in the world. So we will be hopefully a zero spot on this pharmaceutical. But what's cool is this is the first time the state's ever asked us. Before, we were just, you know, there'd be sea monsters. There was a big blank space where Nantucket was. They didn't know what was down here. So it's really cool that we're included. Here's the sonar imaging that Mark Borelli's boat is doing. And basically, it's bouncing. This is eelgrass right here, and he's going to stitch these two together. So this shows, you can actually see a conch shell, you can certainly see a boat. It's mapping using high resolution the sea floor, and we can see how the eelgrass is doing. We can measure what's changing. These are little ripples, micro ripples formed by currents. You can learn all kinds of information looking at this image, and they're going to be really, really cool. This is taken up on Wheel Fleet, and this is oyster cultures that are on that side. They can tell how oysters are doing. Here's my junior scientist program. A lot of, I accept applications every year for junior scientists. They do most of the research for me. They are anywhere from 13 to 20 years of age, And I have different junior scientists that run their own boats in some cases, and I have one young lady that took care of Sacagawea, another person was doing Washing Pond, two kids were doing the harbor. So I'm, as you can see, just one person, and without this huge team of really smart kids, almost all of whom are able to get into the college of their choice because they've had hands-on science. In fact, I've got 20 references to write this week, so if anyone wants to help me. But this makes a huge difference for these kids. They get to do real science, and it's real data. It's not playtime science. It's actually, and there's a lot of other programs on island that are like this. Almost all of them, I track them, and they've become environmental lawyers. They work as an environmental consultant. Several of them have become scientists, and they do a lot of mentorship on the island. Here's our summer classes. We have a series of summer classes. This is our biology class. We have classes in ecology, biology, GIS, and in painting, and several other classes we offer every summer. They're open to Nantucketers at a discount, so definitely talk to me about this. Here we are on the shearwater, playing with some spider crabs, learning about what all is in the harbor in the summertime. And this continues into spring. The toughest group of students last year, from January 20th until April 20th, they got 17 credits. It was 17 students, including two or three students from Nantucket, and they got a whole set of courses here on island. And we're going to repeat it this January, and registration's right now. It's going to be from now until about November 15th. And the classes that we're going to offer right now are going to be more liberal arts and environmental history. I'm going to teach oceanography. I might be teaching natural science. So we're going to have a variety of things. And each of these students also did research. And we did the first bycatch research program on island. Bycatch is all the other stuff you catch when you're looking for scallops or looking for shrimp or conchs. We did the first bycatch study to see what kind of other creatures are hauled up. Coastal resiliency, we're doing a lot of things looking at how our coasts are adapting to sea level change. This is the fuel station during the big storm Nemo. This is on CNN. You can see our poor Barrier Beach getting completely overridden by the storm, and that actually happened again in Saturn and in Sandy. And so it was pretty striking how much. In fact, that's probably why our scalloping is not very good right now. Half the scallops came up onto the beach, the other half of the sand all covered the eelgrass and scallops, so our scalloping's not great right now in front of the fuel station. Here is, I think this is not too long after Sandy, some of the sand that's entrained in the water that's coming off the island, so you can see where this erosion occurs and where the sand is going. The next one's going to be pretty shocking. This is, look how much sand. This is all re-entrained sand from the storm, from the nor'easter, from Nemo, and you can see this is all with the snow cover. That's a lot of sand movement. And so that's what I'm gonna have the sonar ship going as evaluating where all that sand is going. Got a weather station at the field station. That's the link for the field station. Right now, if you're bored, if you haven't heard enough of me, you can go online and listen more for free. I should pay you, but this is our open, massive open online course. We're doing this just like MIT and Harvard are doing this. This is a free course. It runs 5 weeks. It's a great way for someone who's thinking about going to college to kind of get their feet wet in a college course. So believe it or not, I'm like doing my David Attenborough thing out on the water, talking with the camera and everything, and explaining things about erosion, about salinity. And we have resources where you can learn about things and have links to things, and we even have tests. And it's pretty simple, but it's a great way for kids, young students, or people who are returning students to see if college is their deal. And it offers 2 to 3 credits. It's not the same as a full credit course, but it is interactive. Some of these courses have 3,000 or 4,000 students in them. This one, I think we've only got about 150 enrolled, but all of these students actually participate online and through this. And this is called a MOOC. And then we have our Nantucket semester, which is starting in spring 2014. We're just now developing the classes for that. We're going to actually tailor the classes based on the students that enroll. So we're talking to the students. We've got a bunch of faculty members that are working with the NHA here. We've got an archivist that will be able to send down archival interns to work with the NHA and actually work in the archive. We have some smart people here that are really helping us a bunch with this. So this is a great new thing for the field station and for the island, is to give opportunities to students based on history. We have one of the greatest resources in the world for historical research. and for historical thought, for looking at women's studies, for studies on people of color. We've got so many smart people on this island that can help these students learn. So this is something that we're trying to emphasize, and this is very different than what the field station's done in the past. So we're looking at our cultural resources. I'm gonna skip over the opportunities unless you guys all wanna work for me, but if you do, you can do any of those. And here's my sunset. By law, all oceanographers have to end their talk with a sunset, and here's a sunset at Folgers Marsh, which you guys are always welcome to come look at in person. So thank you very much for your time and your patience, and I have 10 minutes for questions. Yay. Thank you. Do we have any? Yes. That's a question we get asked a lot, is should we try to open up the head of the harbor? The bad thing is it would close up almost immediately. It would help temporarily, and it's really helped in Nantucket. So the best example of that was when we have the cut open there at Esther's Island. When Esther's Island goes from Smith's Point to Esther's Island, all of Nantucket, all of the eelgrass really, really freshens up. All that lingbia comes up, and we get much better circulation and much better flushing. So it helps a lot, but it changes the dynamics. A lot of times it buries some of the eelgrass, and if we did something at the head of the harbor, A, it would be bad for Great Point or for Code 2, B, it would seal up almost immediately. So we've, in all of these different policy plans, we've looked at opening up that. And there are models that show how that would change. It would make things really good for a while, but it wouldn't. It's the same idea with Hummock Pond. We open Hummock Pond in Sacagawea every year, and it closes itself back up within 3 to 5 days. And the same thing, we would have to have the world's bravest dump truck driver just standing there every day, keeping that open. And we don't know what would happen to Great Point. Great Point might go away completely. I mean, there's a lot of unintended consequences from that. Now, sea level rise might fix cleaning up our harbor quite a bit. I think our harbor is actually going to improve because we are making a lot of changes in fertilizer use and in septic systems. The fact that, you know, my neighbors have changed their septic systems, I've changed our septic systems. It doesn't take very many homes to mess things up, and it doesn't take a whole lot to fix things. So things are slowly fixing themselves, and I think that we are doing a lot to make things better, but we have to be vigilant, you know, and we can't give up. I saw two more hands back here. Yep, all the way back. Ralph? What makes our, there's about, the neat thing is there, the salt marsh and the freshwater pond that I've got there at the field station, they both have a really thick layer of mud, and there's a, this bacteria, Geobacter, is an actual creature. It is a bacteria, and it just loves the pH, the salinity, and the chemical makeup of the mud. And for some reason, whatever our amount of clay and mud is just perfect for them. And it's unusual, even though there's lots of silt and mud up. And it's not the same as Neponsin. I mean, Neponsin's got to deal with 200 years worth of tanning factories. And when you start thinking about how clean our place is compared to the rest of the world, we're really, really fortunate. And the nice thing is it's convenient to them. So they can come and get this mud. They actually set up this really cool thing which talked to them all the way back in Amherst, and it beamed cell signals, and it showed what the electrical current was in the mud in real time, which is just blew me away. And this was 10 years ago when it was super duper technology. You're welcome. Yep. Yep.
You mentioned the animals that are not here, and how lucky we are that we don't have foxes and raccoons, et cetera. What about the feral cats?
Feral cats and swans are, we have with, as part of the Nantucket Biodiversity Initiative, we have an invasive species committee, and I'm one of the members of the invasive species committee, and we're actually doing work with feral cats and with swans. Swans are also invasive. There's a couple of other creatures that are invasive. The feral cats act as our primary predator on island. I'm a big fan of the trap, neuter, and release. I think that we should neuter them. There's a lot of people on the committee that believe that we should actually get rid of all the feral cats and have an active culling program. My only concern with that is how would that affect Lyme disease? How would that affect all of the rodents? Even though a lot of the raptors act as our primary predator, and I'm an oceanographer, not a biologist, I will preface that. So I don't have a degree in ecology, but one of my concerns is if we remove the feral cats, how important is their niche? I think they should be controlled, and limited, but I'm not 100% convinced we should pull them completely out. But I know that they're a big problem for birds. Obviously, feral cats are the biggest problem for bird populations and take out quite a bit. So that's a really good point. Most of the shorebirds are predated on mainly by rats, but cats are seen in Eel Point and out at Great Point. We do have people that work for the trustees that actually measure and record how many feral cats, you know, whether there are feral cat footprints. That's where your web-based camera work can help you, so you can set up nighttime cameras and see if you've got a problem. If you see a feral cat, you can start putting up traps and relocating them. So you can use remote sensing type things and have things that are looking 24/7 to see what kind of problem you have. But that's a very good question. That's something we're starting to study. Nantucket would be an awesome place to study this. And they're studying on the mainland, but they have to worry about feral cat populations moving in. Once again, we're our own little laboratory. So this is a perfect place to study stuff like that. Another question? Let me ask Susan, and then I'll come back to you.
Thank you.
Uh-huh. Yes, I can, yeah. And they're difficult, but they're online. So the Article 68 work group was formed based on a provision that Smitty and myself brought to town meeting. We basically wanted only slow-release fertilizer in very low quantities used at all. We had a group that formed out of that with landscapers and the guys from the golf courses, and they worked together along with Ernie and Cormac and a lot of people in the industry to hammer out a compromise, which I'm sure Congress probably, you know, could take some lessons from. So they worked for a year on this, and the compromise is much more conservative than what I would like. But I pulled myself completely out of the process, and these guys worked it out. The two things that they learned is organic fertilizers aren't as great as we think. They're like natural foods. If you eat natural potato chips, you still can't eat the whole bag. So people a lot of times are like, oh, it's organic, you know, and they just start throwing it all over their lawn. The really bad thing is we can't apply fertilizers based on the manufacturer's recommendations, because those are written for America. They're not written for a sandy soil. And it's not really fair to insist that they actually make new stuff for us, but instead we have to act as if, I don't know, we're postmenopausal women and everything's going to stick to our butts. That's going to be what's going to happen with our fertilizer. When we're putting fertilizer on our lawns, we have to assume most of it's going to go straight into the groundwater, because it's going to. So you want to fertilize more frequently, little bits, so that the plant takes it up. If I can measure it, you're flushing money away. And I can measure it in many, many places around the island. I could probably quantify how many millions of dollars people are flushing away. So smart fertilizing is a little bit at a time, just when your grass needs it. Never fertilize before it's going to rain. Don't fertilize when your grass isn't growing. I think we need to be much more restrictive on when we start fertilizing in spring and when we stop in fall. I understand that the roots need some fertilizer, but they don't need as much as that dang Scottish guy on TV tells you. Every time I see him, I get mad. Feed it! No, don't feed it. Feed it, and if it starts dying, then feed it a little bit more, but don't just keep feeding your kid constantly and hope that they can process. Our lawns can't process all that. So I'm hoping people also get used to the old-fashioned way on Nantucket, where a Cape Cod lawn was not this emerald green crazy thing. And half the lawns for mosquito testing, this is what's really funny. When I go step on a lawn, there's so much pesticides, and they're so mushy. They're a giant mosquito growing ground, basically. They're a habitat, and the pesticide use and cancer is not cool. I mean, if you can't handle a little bit of grab grass, then once we start realizing the connections to both bees and to breast cancer and to pets and to pesticides, I really hope people will use very little weed and feed. So separate out the weed and feed, spot treat, feed just a little bit, you know, leave your grass clippings. There's a whole series of things, but just do everything thoughtfully. It's the same thing as, you know, trying to eat and lose weight. You know, try to be thoughtful with your nutrition for your lawn like you are for your body. That would be my take home. I'll go to her and then back to you, Liz. Yep.
The group we now see that grows here, how does that compare to the supplements that were recommended to be eating?
There's millions of different types of cyanobacteria. And you can eat, you know, when you ingest the blue-green algae supplements, there are literally like 250 species. So what you take naturally, not that I'm a big supplement fan, but it won't affect you like what's in this pond. We can't package it for that. Though that's not a bad idea, but it's so toxic. The problem is when it breaks down, it releases neurotoxins. And so that's the problem for dogs. Dogs are swimming around in here. They're drinking the water. Some of them don't make it to the car. It goes straight to the liver, and it acts like mustard gas. So it's the breakdown products of these bacteria, and they're just doing their job. They're little alien creatures. They could be living on Mars. They're just processing, you know, chemicals and living their life, and they're enjoying themselves. They're not trying to kill us. It's not necessarily an adaptation thing. But when they break down, they produce. It's the same thing. Red tide has the paralytic shellfish poisoning. That's a similar, you know, when you're in the south and in areas where red tide is really bad. People can't eat shellfish that have been in red tide because they can get paralytic shellfish poisoning. It's the same, it's a similar type toxic reaction. But no, you can take your supplements and not die. Not, unfortunately, I don't think we can package them. Liz? Yeah.
Spraying for ticks.
Yeah.
I was talking to a grandmother a few weeks ago who shot the socks off of me when she says she had her lawn sprayed because her grandchildren were coming over. Is it as bad as my reaction was? Because I'm thinking, why would you do
that?
Yeah,
there's different products out there. There's some products out there that are safer. There's some garlic sprays that are not too bad. But if you are killing ticks, you are putting a pesticide down, and almost every type of pesticide, including the natural ones, people go, oh, it's made from chrysanthemums or mums. Well, napalm is too. There's tons of natural things. We just talked about three types that can kill you, you know. So, I mean, if my grandkid was coming over, I would not spray. I would check my child very carefully for ticks. I would keep them in mowed areas. Overwatering is really a big problem for ticks. Ticks like humidity. They like 85% humidity. So when we have big droughts, it's awesome because we don't have problems with the ticks. But I wouldn't spray your lawn with stuff. There's so much more danger from the pesticides for your grandkids. If you're going to spray your lawn, don't let your grandkids out on it. You know, so it's different if they're standing there with shoes on and stuff. But be super cognizant of what your kids are. Our kids are burdened with so many. You know, I could do a two-hour talk just on environmental factors. And that's why scientists like me can measure these tracers. These are all tracers that you can measure in Antarctica and the Arctic. So when in doubt, don't spray, and just check your kid for ticks.